are here to declare His praise and His praise alone. It is still the season of Easter, if you didn't know. We celebrate Easter all the way through Pentecost, and so we are reminded each of these weeks of the risen God who we get to serve, that it's all because of Him that we can come together in this community and lift up our praise to Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, good morning, church. If you are joining with us here in this sanctuary, we welcome you in this space. If you are joining with us online, we are so grateful to get an opportunity to worship that risen King together, to get to lift up our songs, to be united in our praise to Him in whatever season you might be facing, and to be centered upon the Word and empowered by the Holy Spirit throughout this morning. And so this morning, as we continue in our worship, let us center ourselves in that Word of God. And the psalm from the lectionary this morning is from Psalm 148, and it has just been a blessing as I've read it over and over yesterday and today, the reminder that we are invited to join in the praise of God, the Creator of all things, the Creator of heaven and on earth, and of each and every one of us, and that we are invited to join that song of praise, that even nature declares His praise, and that we can join it too. So in this room and online, would you read this opening scripture with me? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise Him from the skies. Praise Him, all His angels. Praise Him, all the armies of heaven. Praise Him, sun and moon. Praise Him, all you twinkling stars. Praise Him, skies above. Praise Him, vapors high above the clouds. Let every created thing give praise to the Lord, for He issued His command, and they came into being. He set them in place forever and ever. His decree will never be revoked. Praise the Lord from the earth, you creatures of the ocean depths. Fire and hail, snow and clouds, wind and weather that obey Him. Mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all livestock, small scurrying animals and birds, kings of the earth and all people, rulers and judges of the earth, young men and young women, old men and children, let them all praise the name of the Lord, for His name is very great. His glory towers over the earth and heaven. He has made His people strong, amen, honoring His faithful ones, the people of Israel who are close to Him. Praise the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Amen. There is no name on heaven or on earth that is higher than the name of Jesus, amen. Let's sing this together.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fail me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and you put me back together. And every desire now satisfied here in your love.
Sing, there's nothing better.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. To show you my weakness, my failures and flaws, Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend.
Thank you, Lord.
Because the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. Yeah. Come on. Oh, there's nothing
Take a look from wherever you are. If you're in the room with us, take a look out these side windows. If you're with us online, if you can look outside, if you have, depends on where you are in the country, if you have trees. The Bible says that in the presence of the Lord, the trees clap their hands. Think about that. What it means to praise God, not just we human beings who were made to do so, but all of creation, all creatures here below. So what a blessing, what a privilege, what a gift it is for us to join our hearts, our voices, even our hands. The trees are clapping ahead of us. What a gift and a blessing it is for us to be able to do that today. Amen. Amen. That's why we're so thankful for these windows in this sanctuary, that every time you come into this space, and if you are with us online, I hope you can join us in this space sometime where you can see the beauty of God's creation, intentionally so, worshiping with us, or maybe it's us worshiping with creation. Either way, what a blessing it is to be a part of it. Amen. Amen. All right. I promise I'm not going to give you a sermon before the sermon today. I will not do that. I swear. Last week, Aaron and I had the privilege of being, you have a seat, please, have a seat. We're going to gather around the table here, and I want you to be able to be seated at the table. Last week, Aaron and I had a chance to get away for a couple of days, and so thank you for that. And what we missed in our absence was our dear sisters from Mercy Multiply being with us, coming back last week. And so awesome to have you with us. Oh, it's been way too long, and we're so thankful to have you here. Such a gift, and so we're honored to get to worship with you and continue just following Jesus together. So thank you for being here with us. It's such a blessing and a privilege. Thank you. So when we come around the table and we're going to share in our shared confession of faith, the Apostles' Creed, in a moment, and as we do that and as we come and we share in a corporate confession of sin, asking God to forgive us, to put us at right with Him as we confess our sins, and God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins. What we need to understand is one thing. No matter how we embody communion, if it's staying seated in the pews, which we sometimes do, and we receive the juice and the bread, and we all partake of those elements at the same time, seated around the sanctuary, sometimes we do it that way. Sometimes, like we will today, we'll have a time where you'll be invited to come forward as the Spirit leads you, and you'll receive the bread from one brother or sister. You'll receive the cup from another brother or sister. And we'll take those elements into our own bodies as God has invited us to. And there'll also be brothers and sisters here to pray with you. And that's going to be happening up front. It's going to be happening in the balcony. We want to invite you, if you're with us online, if you have elements at home, bread or juice or bread or wine of any sort, if you can be putting those things together now to partake with us, we would invite you to do that. But the point is this: whether we are all in the pews, whether we are moving, and it's kind of like a picture of a human body with a circulatory system where people are moving for prayer, people are moving forward to receive elements, people are seated in their pews praying, or maybe people are moving from one place to another. Maybe God gives you a word of encouragement for somebody, or maybe you need to go to somebody that you realize, I need to ask that person's forgiveness. Sometimes that happens in this time too. But whatever it is, here's what communion is always meant to do. This is the one thing. Communion is always meant to unite us, to unify us in God and with one another as a body. That's who we are. And if communion is something that divides the church, it's pointless. If communion is something that separates us from God and one another somehow, the Apostle Paul says, then we are actually eating and drinking death upon ourselves. Not the life that Christ died and rose again to so freely give those who will come to the table that He has set for us. Does that make sense? So I hope that today, that as we now prepare our hearts and our minds to come together, it is about how are we being united? How is God bringing us together? Not only in our shared profession of faith and our shared confession of sin, but if you stop and think about this same blood of Christ flows through your veins and mine, as well as your brothers and sisters in this room, as well as those who are joining us online. If this same broken body
is what nourishes me, nourishes you, nourishes one another, then what's meant to happen is Christ nourishes and fortifies us, and that is meant to strengthen us that we might nourish and fortify one another, his life, his body, his blood inside working through us. Communion is meant to not just teach us this, but to literally empower us in this as the body of Christ. So wherever you are, if you are able, would you rise to your feet with me? Let's share in this profession of faith that is centuries upon centuries old, what it means for Christians in all times and all places, for generations to profess what it means to follow Christ, what we believe, and how our beliefs are meant to affect who we are in this world as children of God. Would you share in the Apostles' Creed with me? Let us profess. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead, and he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now I invite you, before we corporately confess our sin to a God who is faithful and forgiving, Lord, right now I invite you in just a moment of silence, whatever there may be heavy upon your heart right now. The Holy Spirit does not come to condemn. The Holy Spirit does come to convict us, to show us that which we need to turn over to the Lord, that burden which we cannot carry. So whatever that looks like for you today, whatever that may be as far as sin, whatever that may be as far as fear, whatever that may be as far as anxiety or doubt, whatever that might be right now that you say, Lord, I cannot carry this. Accept his invitation now to confess that to him, to hand that burden to the only one who can carry it for you. Take a moment right now between you and the Lord to do just that. So now would you join with me in this prayer of contrition, a prayer of confession. Let's share in this. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Amen. As a minister of the gospel, it is my joyous privilege to declare to you that if you have confessed your sin to the Lord today, he has removed that from you as far as the east is from the west, that he has cleansed you, that the burden that you have carried no longer belongs to you. In fact, it never did. So walk in the forgiveness, walk in the freedom, walk in the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. And so now at this time, I would like to invite our servers to come forward, and I will serve them these elements that the Lord has shared. And as they're coming forward, let me remind us that on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord took bread, and after blessing it and giving thanks, he broke it and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat, all of you, and do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the meal, Jesus took the cup and he blessed it and he gave thanks. And he said, this cup represents the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for the forgiveness of sins for many. Take and drink of it, all of you. And do this, he said, in remembrance of me. And so today, as we receive the broken body, as we receive the shed blood, know that he gave both, that we would be fortified, that we would be nourished, that we would be strengthened, that we would be healed in our body, soul, mind, and spirit, and that we would be united as one body. Christ's body now upon the earth for such a time as this. This is the meal of victory of our God. The one who was slain, the one who rose again, the one who will come again, but the one who is present now with us by his Spirit as we gather in this space. So come, this is the Lord's table. And if you are seeking him, the one who is already seeking you, you are welcome to receive the gifts of God for the people of God. Amen.
You're invited to partake in this time. Again, the servers will be served first, and then they will be taking their places at the various stations. I also want to invite our prayer team to come forward, and if you want to receive prayer during this time, you can receive prayer from somebody who will have a prayer team badge on, or you can come to the altars if you want to pray on your own, and then we're going to continue to sing and have worship and song. And so take whatever posture it is during this time as you partake in the elements, as you sing and lift up your song of praise, and as you receive prayer.
See you. Jesus for my family,
God, we thank you that we are invited to your presence in this moment and in every moment that we face. And in your presence is fullness of life, is fullness of healing, is fullness of hope, is fullness of breakthrough, is fullness of you. And I pray that we would take the step into the fullness that you are inviting us to in your presence. Right now, I pray for those who have declared that this morning, knowing there is peace in your presence, but saying, I believe, help my unbelief, my circumstances don't feel filled with peace right now. May they experience the peace of your presence that only you can bring. For those who say, I believe, help my unbelief, that there can be healing in this broken relationship that they are facing, may they experience the healing that only you can bring. And may it go far beyond this moment, but may we be present in this moment and in this time of corporate worship for what you have for us. And may we be reminded, even as we step out of this space later today, that your presence is with us wherever we go. And we can simply say, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in my family, in my work, in this difficult situation, in this good situation, you are welcome here. So God, we thank you. We give you all praise and honor and glory. And in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, we say, so be it. Amen. 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 And as we have an opportunity to continue in worship and extend that peace that he gives each and every one of us, I'm inviting you to stand up, and we're going to walk across the aisle in just a moment. But I want to invite all of you online to pass the peace to each other, to use the chat, to say where you're from, to say peace of Christ with you and also with you, to extend and receive that peace online as well as in this room. So would you walk across the aisles and greet each other in the peace of Christ?
Well, hey, y'all, as you're finishing up fellowshipping and passing the peace, I want to turn your attention to over here on the platform. We have some members of our kids' choir who, yeah, we'll go, woohoo! Our kids' choir presented a musical a couple weekends ago called Jailhouse Rock, and it rocked. And we wanted to be able to share a little piece of that with you this morning. These kids work so hard. And I also want to take this chance to say a huge thank you to Miss Joyce Samples for all her work on this. She loves these kids so well. And Joyce and Beverly Barnes and Mandy Jones and Amy Morrow, she had some help too. But Joyce, we love you and we're grateful for you. So, Kids Choir, thank you for working so hard and presenting such a wonderful gospel musical last week. All right, we're going to let you sing for us now. We're excited.
That was awesome. Thank you guys so much. Thanks, Phil. All right. Well, good morning, Christchurch. I'm Shelby Anderson, Director of Communications. It's my joy to welcome you this morning. We're not a perfect church around here. We don't claim to be, but we are an interdenominational. We are a diverse group of believers who believe life is just a little bit better when we follow Jesus together. And so we are so glad you're here. If you're new with us and you've been checking us out for this is your first time or the last couple of weeks, we're not going to embarrass you at all. We're not going to make you stand or raise your hand or come down front, I promise. But what we do want you to do is text us to just say hello. So if that's you, if you're like, I would love to get connected or put a face to a name, we want you to text us the word connect at 615-205-1098. So all that's going to do is trigger a prompt for you to give us a little bit of information, and then we'll reach out to you to schedule a coffee or send you an email or get you connected to Breaking Bread. Who's been to Breaking Bread on Wednesday nights? Oh, come on, there's more hands than that. It's a great time. It's a great time. We want you to come out. We're doing that through the end of May, and we'd love to have you join us. So again, text the word connect, 615-205-1098. All right, so just going to share about a couple more things that are going on in the life of our church. So as Christ Church, we are a people on mission to bring hope and wholeness through Christ. So we don't claim to do that on our own. We need Jesus. Amen? And one of the ways that we are intentionally focusing on living that out this year and beyond is through the growth and intentionality of our recovery care ministry. So many of you know our own Matthew Phillips, who was in kids ministry for a while, has transitioned into growing and developing our recovery care ministry. He's doing a fantastic job. And so we have groups that are meeting right now on Tuesdays and Wednesday nights, but we want to expand that. We want to go beyond divorce care and grief share, as amazing as those are, but we want to add celebrate recovery groups. We want to add grace groups, which focus on mental health, and AA groups. Any group that could really help in the recovery journey, we want to come alongside and offer that as we expand this ministry. And so one of the ways that we do this is through something called a recovery congregation workshop. And a lot of people are like, Shelby, I'm not quite sure what a recovery congregation is. Can you explain it to me? So if you have thought that or wondered that, you're not alone. And so all being a recovery congregation means is that we are state certified to be a safe space and a welcoming place for people that are in recovery. And so as these groups continue to expand, as we continue to wrap our arms around anybody who's in recovery, and to quote Pastor Ben, I think we're all in some form of recovery in one way or another. And so as we wrap our arms around these people, as we want to love them well, we need leaders. We need people that will raise their hand and that will say, you know what? I've been through that. I've been through divorce. I've been an alcoholic, and I'm on the other side, and I want to help people that are in the midst of that and in the trenches of that. And so if that's you, please come next Saturday, 10 a.m., Montel Hardwick Hall. It's going to be on the addicted brain, which is super fascinating to me. And then our own Pastor Greg is going to be there talking about faith and mental health, given that this is Mental Health Awareness Month. And so please come out and join us. It'll be a wonderful time. Register at ccnash.org/recovery. Speaking of Pastor Greg, a little birdie told me that he's also going to be there selling copies of his new book. So let's give it up for Pastor Greg. We are so proud of you. His new book, Living With Our Scars, was just released, and we are just so proud of you, and we love you. And so if you want a copy of the book, come to the workshop. All right. The last thing I want to share with you is about this little thing called VBS. Kids, are we excited for VBS? Woo! All right. Vacation Bible School is one of our biggest community outreach events each year. We're expecting over 200 kids to be all over this campus and dancing and singing and playing games and throwing water balloons. I don't know what they do, but it's going to be so much fun. And so we need your help. So this is not just kids ministry. This is an all hands on deck thing and outreach for us. And so there are three ways that you can help us with VBS. And everyone can do at least one of them, I promise. If you don't have to do all three, but if you want to, then you just get an extra high five from me. So the first way is to join us through prayer. So we have prayer cards that look like this, that we're going to be in the foyer giving out for the next four Sundays. And this one just says, pray for our kids. And the next one might say, pray for our leaders, pray for our families. And so if you can pray, which I'm a firm believer that everyone in this room can pray, as it's one of our core values, we would ask you to do that. The second way is to join us is through serving. So no matter your skill set, your calling, your availability, if you're like, I work full time, I get it. I also work full time and can't serve during the week, then we have opportunities for you to plug in on nights and weekends. You can bring props home. You can come after hours and help with decorations or registration planning. There's a spot for you to plug in. And so if you're like, I can give a few hours of my time, or I can come the whole week and hang out with the kids, that sounds fun. We need you to serve. So please go to ccnash.org/VBS. The last way to get to join us is through giving. So we have made VBS completely free this year. So every kid can come without costs being prohibitive and learn about God's monumental love. And so if you have the means to support us financially, we would appreciate that. And so if you want to drop some cash or check at the foyer in the back, or you can send it through when the offering comes and just note that it's for VBS. You can also give online. We would just love for you to consider supporting VBS financially. Additionally, kids, this is so exciting. During the week of VBS, you guys are going to be donating items for our missions partners, Siloam Health and The Bridge. And so as you continue to bring chips in as a church, we want to give alongside our kids who are going to be bringing more chips in. And so these ministries help other kids throughout our city. And so kids are giving to kids, which is, I think, pretty cool. And so if you want to give alongside them, please do so. If you have any questions about VBS, please come talk to me, find Dr. Bennett, find Pastor Jennifer or Ben. We'll help you get connected. And so as we transition now into a time of giving, I'd like to invite our kids to come forward. I'd like to invite the ushers to get ready to pass the offering. Kids, come on. If you're going to kids' church, we're going to pray over you guys. And just as a reminder, there are three ways to give. You can give through our website, ccnash.org/give. You can text the word give to 615-205-1098, or you can give in person as the bags are passed. All right. Will you bow your heads and join me? Father God, we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you for the gifts that you have given us so that we can give a small portion back to you. God, I pray that you'd be with this offering, that you would break it, that you'd bless it, that you would multiply it, that you would expand it far beyond our imagination, our comprehension, to do your work for the good of your kingdom and your glory. God, I pray that you'd be with these children as they go into their time of learning and worship, that you would cultivate a community among them, that you would cultivate a hunger for your word and to know you personally. God, we love you. We thank you. We ask you just to give us the rest of a wonderful day. Amen.
Good morning, church. As we are standing both in this room and for those who are joining with us online, would you join with me as we look into the word of the Lord coming from the book of Ephesians as we journey into the second chapter? Look now with me at the first 10 verses of Ephesians chapter 1. Hear the word of the Lord. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no man or no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Once again, I welcome you, as it's already been said, both to our church family and to those who are visiting with us this morning for the first time or the first time in a long time, both in this space physically and those who are joining with us online. For those who may not know me, I'm Pastor Greg. I'm one of the staff pastors here at the church. I'm your brother in Christ, and I'm so glad for the opportunity to share in God's word this morning. Thank you, Pastor Ben, for the opportunity. And as you guys notice, I'm sitting this morning, and I'm going to, as best I can, to remain on this stool. For those who know me, I like to move around when I'm preaching and teaching. But I asked to have these here this morning because I want to do just that. I want to teach this morning. So if you have a piece of paper, if you have your phones, I want you to take notes this morning as we share in the word of the Lord. We are continuing our sermon series that was started four weeks ago now, entitled Ephesians. We are looking and walking our way through the book of Ephesians. We're going to spend a little bit of time in this book, as you can tell, because Pastor Ben and Pastor Jennifer, over the past 3 weeks, walked us through the first chapter. It took us 3 weeks to get through the first chapter of Ephesians. So we're going to spend a little time. So kind of take your shoes off. Well, we're not going to spend a lot of time today. But over the course of the upcoming weeks and months, we're going to spend a little time in Ephesians. But the past 3 weeks, Pastor Ben and Pastor Jennifer shared with us from this first chapter two major themes: who Jesus is and who we are in him. And that was expressed in various ways throughout the verses that you find in chapter 1. This past Wednesday at Breaking Bread, and as it was mentioned, you are all invited to join us in Breaking Bread. We meet here Wednesday night. We share a meal, a real meal. Not communion is real, but I mean a common meal. We share a common meal from 5:30 to about 6:25. And then we kind of transition into a time of discussion and study. It's a wonderful time. We're going to have two more sessions before we break for the summer. So you have two opportunities before we wrap up the month of May to join with us. And then we'll pick back up in August. But last Wednesday, we covered the scriptures that Pastor Jennifer so masterfully, so wonderfully, so powerfully preached. She preached last Sunday. Yes, amen. She brought that word last week, and we dug into that at Breaking Bread. You know, in this space, you don't get a chance to ask questions about the sermon or the scriptures or to share your thoughts, but at Breaking Bread, you do. So that's one of the advantages and why we want to invite you to be a part of that. But we were digging into those last couple of verses in chapter 1 where Paul was praying for this Ephesian church. He starts chapter 1 by letting them know he's been giving thanks to God because he's heard of their faith and how they have just shared the love among the fellowship of believers. But he goes in to say, he says, not only do I thank God, but I pray for you that you will have a clearer and a deeper understanding. What of what, Paul? What does Paul want them if they are already walking in their faith, loving each other? What more do they need? Paul says, I'm praying after I give thanks that you will have a clearer and deeper understanding of the power that Jesus has and his headship over the church. Because if you know the power that Jesus has, and you know the headship, the rule that he has over the church, it will change how you see yourself as the body of Christ. We were digging into that last Wednesday. And the point that I shared, which was very personal, is that I need these words in this book to be true. When life happens, and it will if it hasn't already, I need what the Bible says to really be true in my life. What it says about Jesus, about God, and what it has to say about me. I need it to be real. Am I the only one who needs the Word of God to be true? Am I the only one? Am I the only one that life is happening to? Right? Who are facing, am I the only one facing issues personally or indirectly with the ones that I love? I need the word to be true. And this is what Paul prays for this Ephesian church as we close out chapter one, that they will have a clearer and deeper knowledge and understanding of who Jesus is and who they are in Christ. When we get to chapter two, which we are just going to look at the first 10 verses today, Paul is writing here, and he says this phrase in verse 4 that I'm using as the theme of this sermon or teaching today. He says in verse 4, he starts out by saying, "But God." Now, it's interesting because when we transition into chapter 2, Paul really kind of takes us backwards. He's been in chapter 1 telling us who we are now. But he starts out chapter 2 by taking us back to telling us who we were before we became who we are now. Paul talks about in chapter 2 who we are before he talks about, he's going to come back talking about who we are. You know, it really does matter to know how we got here. It really does help to know why people are the way they are. And you don't know that, you don't find that out without tracing it back to the past. Now, we don't live in the past, but certainly knowing the past helps us to understand how we got here, right? And so Paul takes us back to bring us forward. Now, Paul talks about where we were. Paul understood what it meant to live in both worlds. He understood that there was a life before Christ, both for him and for all of us who have accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior. There was a BC before there was an AD. And Paul understood that because before he became an apostle, before he was a missionary, before he was a leader in the church, Paul was the persecutor of the church. And on his way to persecute the church, heading to Damascus, he ran into Jesus. I mean, he ran into Jesus. I mean, he was knocked off of his ride. And he came to the knowledge that the very thing that he was persecuting, which he thought was the right thing to do, was the wrong thing that he was doing because it was the right thing after all. "Who are you, Lord?" Paul said, and Jesus said, "I am the one that you've been persecuting." So Paul understood that there was a way that he lived in his old life that was different than his new life. Are you guys still with me? So here in chapter 2, Paul begins by using a grammatical tool. He uses this tool that we don't really talk about anymore since we got out of grade school. He used this grammatical tool called a conjunction. And actually, in these 10 verses, there are two conjunctions that I want to draw your attention to. First, the first one is found in verse 1, because Paul starts chapter 2 by saying, "And you were dead." I'm going to come back to that phrase. But also, we find that other conjunction in verse 4, which is part of the title of this talk, this preaching, this teaching. But Paul uses the conjunction "and" in verse 1 and the conjunction "but" in verse 4. Now, that brought back memories as I was preparing this sermon today, because growing up as a kid in the 70s, there was this series that was produced first on ABC, then it went over to kind of like PBS. It was called Schoolhouse Rock. Now, Schoolhouse Rock was an animated series that had little short 3 minutes to 5 minutes, little things that showed you how to understand stuff you couldn't understand in school. Hence the phrase, schoolhouse rocks. You know, learning should be fun, but sometimes it's not fun. And the creator of this show noticed that one of his kids was having problems learning math in school. But he realized that his kid could remember songs, right? So he got together with some people, and they came up with this series where they animated math and law and grammar into these little short animated features that normally, when I was growing up, came on TV on Saturdays. So it was like cartoon time, right? No one gets it except for those who are my age or older. But there was one, so there was a lot of different little short animated shows that they would show, but this one is relevant to our talk today. Here's an image, Brian, if you put this one up. You all remember this one? Conjunction, junction, what's your function? Now, everyone who's laughing, teenagers, are old. Everyone. Because y'all probably have no clue what this is. But conjunction, junction, what's your function was like a 3 minute, 50 second, 45 second little show in this series of animated little spots. And it taught you what a conjunction was and what it does. It told us that it hooks up words, phrases, and clause. Y'all can hear the little tune, conjunction, junction, what's your function, right? Okay. And it told us that and, but, and or will get you pretty far. Yeah? But there's other conjunctions, but those are the three that we use mostly, right? So Paul uses these conjunctions, and, but, in these first 10 verses. So let's connect, because we know that a conjunction connects words, phrases, and clause. So let's connect chapter 1 with chapter 2. Chapter 1 tells us all the good stuff, that we've been adopted, that we have this inheritance in Christ, that he is in heavenly places and we are there with him, and that he is the head, but we are the body of Christ. But in chapter 2, at least in the beginning, Paul tells us the other side of the story. He tells us where we were before we got to what he talks about in chapter 1. He says that we are dead in our trespasses and sins, that we've been walking not in heavenly places, but in the pattern or the course of this world, that we are not the body of Christ, but that we were sons of disobedience, children of wrath. And he's not talking about Jesus right in this first couple of verses in chapter 1. He talks about this prince of the power of the air, the spirit of this age. You see the conjunction, junction? What's your function? He ties chapter 2 with chapter 1. Because if you start verse 1 of chapter 2 with the word and, you've got to understand what has already been said, right? So it gives us this glorious view of us being with Christ, Christ being the head, and we being the body as he concludes chapter 1. But then he connects it and says, and you were dead. How would you like that? You go from glory to death, right? He says, you were dead. What does it mean to be dead? It means to be lifeless, without animation. It means to be a corpse without a spirit. It means not totally physically dead, but a spiritual death. And when we read chapter 2, the first couple of verses, 1 through verse 3, Paul gives us kind of a post-mortem report or a forensic analysis of how we died back in the day. He walks us through and he identifies the cause of death, the time and place of death. And he even tells us who the perpetrator or the assailant of death is. Notice what Paul says. He says, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. That means the falling away or the missing of the mark of what we were created to be and what we were created to do. What is sin? Sin is when we don't do what we were created to do. And when we trespass means that we jump a fence that we're not supposed to jump over, or we open a door or kick in a door we're not supposed to kick in or walk through. We are dead when we fall away. We are dead when we miss the mark. It is both a reference to the act of sin and the state of sin. I'm teaching good. Because we can sin. We can trespass. We can make mistakes. But if you're not careful, you'll start living that way. It becomes a lifestyle. And Paul says, we were dead when we did it and when we live that way. But he doesn't stop there, right? He gives us the time and the place of when we were dead. He says, while we were walking in the course of the world, while we were living like the world lives, the patterns, the habits, the passions, the desires, when we were trying to fulfill the flesh desires and the desires of our minds, Paul says, when we did that, we were creating death, not life. How many times we have gotten what we want and we realize it was the worst thing in the world? We achieved some type of status that we thought would fulfill us. And when we got there, we saw that there was another hill that was even higher to climb to get the joy out of life we were searching for. Paul goes on to say that there was this prince of the power of the air, the spirit of the ace that was kind of behind the scenes moving the strings of how we were living our lives. And Paul goes on to say, and the apostles go on to say in other scriptures, how this is true. Because we are reminded that Paul wrote in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, that the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. There is a payday. Back in my tradition, preachers would kind of bring it home in their sermons, but by saying one day, there's a payday. Right? I mean, you live right, you give your heart to Jesus, one day there's a payday. But what you didn't hear too often is that there's also a payday if you don't give your heart to Jesus, or if you live after your own desires and your own will, there's a payday for that, because the wages, the paycheck that we receive from living in our trespasses in sin is death. Jesus, when he was praying for us in John chapter 17, I'm teaching, so write notes or go back and listen to this. John chapter 17, Jesus is praying for us in this passage. And he says, Father, I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but keep them while they're here, Lord. Don't take them out, but keep them while they're in the world. You know, some days I wish he would have prayed, Lord, take them out of the world. Because the world, it can be hard, it can be brutal, it can be mean, it can be nasty. Living sometimes is not rosy, it's stinky and messy. And Jesus says, Lord, I'm not praying that you take them out of the world, but keep them while they're here. That's the hope right there. No, he's not gonna take us out of the world. He's not gonna remove every problem, but he's gonna keep us. Sometimes you pray and ask God to remove the thorn and he says no. He says, my grace, which we're gonna talk about here in a minute, is sufficient. And then we also hear Paul later in this very book, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, Paul says that we are in a match. We are fighting something. We are wrestling with something. But it's not what you think it is. Because in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, Paul says, well, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Stop trying to win battles with people. Stop trying to win battles with people as a Christian. Now, if you want to fight them not as a Christian, you go at it. You fall, put your flag in the sand, fall on the sword, fight every fight that you think you're big enough to fight, if you want to do that. But Paul says we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. It's not the political party. It's not the agenda. It's not any of this stuff that we attach a face of a person to or a face to a party. You're mistaken. We're mistaken. We don't wrestle as Christians against flesh and blood, but conjunction, what's your function? We do wrestle against something and someone, but it's not flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against cosmic powers over the present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Listen, Paul in the early church believed that sin causes death, that we are not citizens of this world, and that the devil is real and evil is real. Because when Jesus was praying, Lord, don't take them out of the world, but keep them, he goes on to say in verse 16 of John 17, because they are not of this world. Did you hear what Jesus said about you as a Christian and me as a Christian? We are not of the world, meaning that we are like ETs, we're extraterrestrials here on this planet. Yeah, we have a physical body. Yes, there's a hospital or a home that we were born in that you can put an address to, but your spirit man, your spirit person, the real you, didn't come from the dirt of the earth. It came from the heavenly Father. You are not of this world, so stop investing all of your energy in this world. I'm not saying that we're not stewards of it, but some of us are going to be so bankrupt spiritually because we give everything to this world. But you are not of this world. I'm an American citizen, I'm a military veteran, but my true citizenship, I thank God for my country, I fought for my country, but my true citizenship, my true passport, I'm a child of the living God. I'm a citizen of heaven. And when I forget the order of that, I get messed up. And so do you. Paul in the early church believed that sin causes death, that as believers we're not of this world, and that the devil is real. I wanted to take a little time in this sermon today to really harp on this. As Christians, we forget that the spirit world is real. And I'm not just talking about the good part of the spirit world, the Holy Spirit, the holy angels, God, Jesus. I'm talking about the devil, demonic spirits. Now, I'm not here to spook you out, but I am here to remind you that these things are real. The devil is not just a figment of our imagination or a term used to identify sin. They are two different things. Sin and the devil are two different nouns. The devil is real. The apostles in the early church believed that sin causes death. They were from another place and that there was a real devil and that evil was real because Jesus told them that. Jesus said, and you can read it in our printed Bible, that there is a real devil. He tells us that sin is real, evil is real, heaven is real, hell is real. Jesus taught the church that these things were real. That's why they believed it. Now, I want you guys, when you're looking at situations that are so messed up and so opposite of God's plan and God's will, as not just being a political issue, a cultural issue, a preference issue, but I want you to see the puppeteer behind the scenes. Because Paul says there is a prince, a ruler of the power of the air. And he goes on to say that this prince is a spirit, right? I mean, not the person you're mad at who has a name and a birth certificate. I'm talking about someone who was before we showed up in physical form here on earth. But Paul doesn't leave us there. He takes us there to remind us how blessed we are. If you were dead, if you had a prognosis of a deadly, life-threatening disease, it would change, or it should, it would change how you live the rest of your life once you have been cured or healed or made better. When I had my surgery February of last year, colon cancer took out a good portion of my colon, I was glad to be alive. I had a fresh perspective on health and life. When you have issues, you appreciate when you don't have issues. Can I get a good amen? Amen. And regardless if you know it or not, everyone has issues. Some of us cover it up a little bit better. We know how to apply the foundation a little bit better than others. And sometimes it's cyclical, sometimes it's seasonal, right? Sometimes you are breathing fresh air and sometimes you are sucking wind, right? It just depends. But Paul takes us from despair, verses 1 through verse 3, and he brings hope. And how does he do it? He does it with a conjunction. He says, but God. Isn't that good? He says, but God. You know, that word but is my favorite word in the Bible. It is my favorite word in the Bible because it represents a pivot point. It represents a turnaround. It is the conjunction between what I was to what I am and what I will be. Everybody needs a but. You're messed up. Your family's messed up. Your career's messed up. Your business is messed up. Your health is messed up. But some of us need to know that there's a but. You're living in the valley of the shadow of death. You're stuck in verses 1 and 3 of chapter 2. But you need to know that there's a but in chapter in verse 4. That's in chapter 3. You're stuck in verses 1 and 3 of chapter 2, but you need to know there's a but in verse 4. Notice what Paul says. He says, but God being rich in mercy because of the great love which he loved us. You know, mercy and love are agents of transformation. Notice how Paul uses the rich language here in this verse. He says God doesn't just have mercy. He says God is rich in mercy. You know the difference between poor and rich, right? Everyone, you know the difference between being poor and rich. Let me give you another one. You know the difference between being okay and rich? Because sometimes we forget that there's an in-between of poor and rich. I mean, you could be like middle class, upper middle class, and you're okay. You can pay your bills and all of that, but it doesn't mean you're rich. I'm teaching good. It says, but God, who is rich in mercy. How is God loaded? He's loaded richly in mercy. Mercy simply means pity and compassion. I'm going to tell you why here in a second. It's important for you and I to know that God is not hurting for mercy. He's loaded. His bank account is loaded with mercy because of the great love that he has for us, that he loves. How does God love you and I? He doesn't just love us any kind of way. He has a great love. You know the difference between just liking something and loving something? Everyone knows the difference between liking something and loving something. Now, do you know the difference between loving something and really loving something? There's a difference. You know, the Bible says in John 3:16, it says this. It says, for God loved the world. John 3:16 says, God loved the world. No, it says God so. And that so makes a difference. That so shows you to what intensity he loves you. For God so loved the world that he gave. That's what mercy does. God, who is rich in mercy, because he so loved us. What did he do? Let me find it here. That even when we were dead in our trespasses, our BC, before Christ, before we got our stuff together, God's mercy, because it was motivated by love, what did it do? Even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you have been saved. Do you all see what happens, that word but, that turnaround point? When you are dead, before you can even fix your own self, God's mercy comes in. And how does God's mercy come in? It says, because we are saved by what? By grace. Do you know what grace is? Grace is mercy in action. That's what grace is. You know, we have this these songs, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. You know, Amazing Grace, you know, grace is something that you can't buy, you can't afford, you don't have enough. I don't care how educated, how well known you are, what family you come from or don't come from. Grace is something you don't deserve it. But mercy in action shows up in grace, and while we were dead. Remember verses 1 and 3? While we were dead, it says that we were made alive. You know, we're not waiting for heaven. We're looking forward to heaven, but we're not waiting for heaven. You know, God makes us alive, not in the by and by. He makes us alive right now. Why are we trying to wait to live victorious lives as Christians when we get to heaven? Why are we not finding in the victory down here in this life when we've already been made alive through Jesus Christ? And he goes on to say, and we have been raised up with him and seated us in heavenly places in Jesus Christ. You see that? It's right there. When are you seated in heaven? When do you get to heaven? Not just when you die, you're already seated. There's a place already reserved for you. And we are seated with Christ in heavenly places, so that in the coming ages we might show, that God may show the immeasurable riches of his grace to us. He goes on to say in these passages that not only has mercy shown up in our lives through grace, and God knows we need some grace, but it says that we receive that grace through faith. You know, some of us have really lost hope. Really, really lost hope. I mean, it's been that long. It's been that hard. I mean, you know all the cliches, you know all the scriptures, you know what it's supposed to be. But the reality is, it ain't that. Sorry for the grammar. It is not that. It is not that way. It's not what the Bible says. But notice what Paul goes on to say here in Ephesians 2. He says, verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Grace shows up, mercy shows up as grace in our lives. But the grace is not something that we can manufacture. You can't talk your way into grace, per se. You can't work your way into grace, per se. You can't buy your way into grace. Paul says that it is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. And today, some of us really need a present to show up. We really need the unexpected to happen. We need grace to come as a present, like on Christmas morning. We need grace in our situations. In our circumstances, we need grace. Paul goes on to say, it's not a result of our works, so that no man can boast. I cannot give myself a pat on the back because I had enough faith to make it happen. I can't do that. This past week reminded me how limited I am, even as one of your pastors. It reminded me this week that if God doesn't do it, it can't be done. If God can't fix it, it cannot be fixed. And the thing that I needed this week for God to fix was something that I don't think I could live without, because it was attached to a person that I love. What do you do when a train wreck is happening and you can't do anything about it? You better hope that this is real. And you better hope you know what it says that you can expect and what you can believe for. And you better know who you are, but you better know that it's not you doing it, that it's a gift of God. For we, verse 10, he ends by saying, for we are his workmanship. Here's the beauty right here. We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. I tried to wrap my mind around this passage as we're preparing to close today, because I think God wanted this to be kind of where we put our pen into the wall today to say, that's it. No matter what verses 1, 2, and 3 says about our old selves, but in light of what verses 4 through verse 10 tells us that God has done that we were not able to do for ourselves. Verse 10 tells us that God's been working on something. You see that? This whole time, AD and BC, this whole time, God has been working on something. And you know what he's been working on? He's been working on you, and he's been working on me. Let me leave you with this passage here. Let me give you one other one. Jeremiah was told to go to the potter's house because God wanted to show him something. Thank you, Lord. Remember that? He wanted him to see something that was an illustration of what God was doing in the nation of Israel. Jeremiah goes to a physical potter's house, people who make vessels out of clay. And he saw this potter at work. And as he was forming the clay, the potter saw something as a blemish in the vessel that he was making. And as Jeremiah was looking at the potter, he writes and says that the potter brought the clay back down to formless clay, and he remade the vessel. And God told Jeremiah, I can do the same thing with the nation. Come on up, Chris. Oh, Christopher's already up. In our lives and our situations that have been dead for a long time, I mean so dead, it's kind of like Lazarus in the grave. He's been dead 4 days. If you open up that grave, it's gonna stink. Some of us have some stinky stuff that's been dead a long time, and there seems to be no hope. But like the potter who's been working on that clay, that wheel is still spinning. The clay is still moist, and the potter can redo what's wrong. Matthew wrote in Matthew chapter 5, verse 14 through 16, says, you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. And we read here in Ephesians chapter 2, the end of verse 10, it says, for we are God's workmanship, created for God in Christ for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk therein. Father, it is in Jesus' name that we give you thanks for your word. Thank you today that you are just real with us. You don't hide anything from us. And today you reminded us, Lord, just how far we had fallen before we came to the knowledge of who Jesus is. But while we were yet in our sin, while we were yet lifeless, and as Matthew Henry says, sin is the death of the soul. When we couldn't even know what to ask for, your mercy showed up in grace and found us in our state of death and made us alive again in Christ. Father, I pray that in each of our lives today, those in this room, those that are watching online, and those that would watch this recording in the days to come, would you remind us, Father, that resurrection power is still moving and working? And as we bring those dead things to you, Lord, would you speak life into them? Would you breathe life into them? Lord, we are a work in progress. Continue to work on us. Continue to shape and form us into the image of your Son, because we know that we have been destined to do good works. Now, Lord, show us. Would you guys receive this today? Lord, would you show us how you want us to walk this out? How you want us to be your hands and feet, your body? When we see the enemy at work in our world, in us, would you give us the courage to call that out for what it is? Would you help us to stop fighting people and to fight the fight that we are called to fight as Christians? Would you help us, Lord, to put on the whole armor of God that we can be able to stand? Lord, thank you. We're in overtime, guys. We are past the mark where we normally wrap up. But right where you're sitting, I want you to do something. Would you just, in the privacy of your little space, call out those things that are dead in your life? I want you to put a name to it. Let's make it real. What are the things? What are the relationships? What are the issues that are dead in your life that only God can bring back to life? What's the name of that person? What's the name of that thing? Give that to God this week and let Him work His good work in you and in that situation. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As we prepare, thank you, brother. As we prepare to leave today, we have one other thing that we need to do. We've got some business to take care of. Ever so often in the life and rhythm of our church, we get to participate in the good work that God is doing. And at this point in our service, we're going to prepare our hearts to give an offering. This offering is not for me, but this is an offering that is part of our benevolence ministry here at our church. Throughout the week, throughout the month, the needs of our community and the needs of our church family are presented to us. We are given an opportunity to see how God will allow us to come alongside someone who's having a tough time in their lives. And so as our ushers are coming, and before we pray, I want you to take just a second and ask the Lord, what would He have for you in your home to give towards our benevolence offering today? Remember what Paul says in verse 10, that we were created for good works. And one of the wonderful things that I've learned in life is that when I look outside of myself and find ways of blessing others, God has a funny way of blessing me and giving me more than what I need. Can I get a good witness on that one? Amen. Amen. So as you're preparing to give, the ushers will pass the offering bags down each aisle. Before they do that, let's pray and ask God's blessing over the gifts. Father, thank you for the opportunity to give now. as we sow into the lives of people that we may not ever know their names, we may never know their situation, but God, we know what it feels to be in need. We've been there and we have done that. And we are so thankful that at the point of our need, there was someone that you spoke to that was there for us. May in some small way and in some big way, may we be there for someone else now. In Jesus' name, bless the gifts and the giver. And amen. Amen. God bless you as you give.
If you'd like, sing this song with me. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Would you stand? Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your attentiveness. Thank you for allowing me to go a little bit longer than I normally go. I pray that this word today is a seed planted into your hearts, that it will bring encouragement, and that it will bring fruit that not only you will enjoy, but others that God will bring you in contact with. Would you receive this blessing as we prepare to leave? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and bless you so richly this week. Go now and serve the Lord. God bless you. We love you.